Good evening. My name is Evan Stankovics, Adult Programming Librarian at the Northside Library, and on behalf of the Jefferson Madison Regional Library System, welcome to the virtual program, Gospel Music and Civil Rights, a documentary and discussion with Claudrena Harold. Thank you so much for joining us this evening, and please do remember to keep checking jmrl.org for a complete and frequently updated schedule of virtual programs for all ages. Don't miss the Lift Every Voice series of programs celebrating Black poetry. From Dial a Poem to a virtual art gallery to an evening with Black poets, visit jmrl.org for a complete listing and details how to register. Tonight's event and all JMRL events have been made possible by the incredible support of the Friends of the Library. For anyone curious, the mics have been muted for this evening's program. We ask that any questions you may have, you please save for the end of the presentation. You can enter them into the chat box at the bottom of your screen. Or if you prefer to ask your question out loud, please utilize the raise hand feature. This can be accessed by selecting participants at the bottom of your screen and selecting raise hand. If you're joining us by phone this evening, you would simply press *9 to activate the raise hand feature. Again, we ask you please save all questions until the designated Q&A session at the end of the program. With that said, it is now my pleasure to introduce to you tonight's presenter. Claudrena Harold is a professor of African American Studies and History at UVA. In addition to publishing and co-editing 6 books and numerous articles, Professor Harold, with a focus on the history of Black student activism at UVA, has written, produced, and co-directed 8 short films with Kevin Jerome Everson. These films have been screened around the world at the National Gallery of Art, the Whitney, the London, Vienna, and Berlin film festivals, to name only a few. Professor Harold's most recent work, the subject of this evening's presentation, is the book When Sunday Comes, Gospel Music in the Soul and Hip Hop Eras. Here to discuss this work, please help me welcome Claudrena Harold.
So I'll get started again. Once again, it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks so much for the opportunity to present on this book, When Sunday Comes, Gospel Music in the Soul and Hip Hop Era. As I noted, this is an honor. It's an honor to be able to talk about this music within the context of sort of a library community. No other institution, once again, had a more profound impact on my development as a scholar as it related to gospel music than the public library. In the 1980s, when my love of the art form of gospel music intensified, I not only religiously purchased the records of my favorite artists like James Cleveland and Shirley Caesar and Andre Crouch and the Staples Singers, but I also devoured publications like Jet Magazine, Ebony Magazine, Contemporary Christian Music Magazine, and Billboard. Billboard, which went for about $8 an issue, and my mother was not going to purchase that for an 8-year-old. It was within the context of this literature and reading these magazines in the library that I immersed myself in heated debates about the direction of Black sacred music, gospel music. Had gospel music betrayed its sacred roots and lost its connection to the prophetic tradition of the Black church? Were the contemporary gospel artists who experimented with the rhythms of funk, soul, jazz, and hip hop more concerned with selling records than saving souls? Or was the new wave of gospel musicians simply doing what their predecessors had done? Predecessors like the Staples Singers, employing new technologies and new marketing strategies to fulfill their broader evangelical mission. Listening to these debates as a teenager provided me with a critical language and a historical context to process music conversations taking place on A&M radio stations, at churches, and in the homes of families and family and friends. In many ways, my latest work, When Sunday Comes, represents a continuation of a long communal conversation involving a host of individuals and institutions. As a child, gospel music was very much a part of my sonic landscape. And gospel music shaped me just as much as the pop ballads and infectious grooves of Whitney Houston, Prince, Luther Vandross, and Anita Baker. And of course, that art form, hip hop. thanks in large part to my mother's refusal to compartmentalize the secular and the sacred, there was no genre of African American music that was excluded from our working class home. The joy with which she discussed her first time seeing James Cleveland as a student at Florida A&M University in Tallahassee, Florida, equaled her passionate recollections of seeing James Brown at the Veterans Memorial Coliseum in Jacksonville. In my house, we listened to the Staples Singers' I'll Take You There with the same intensity that we listened to the sultry Let's Do It Again. So, telling this story about the history of gospel music and writing this book, When Sunday Comes, it's a labor of love. I tell the story of gospel music from the late 1960s until the mid-1940s. And I look at the period that some would call the post-golden age period of gospel music. The story of gospel music's evolution in post-Jim Crow America is a beautifully complex one that can be told from a variety of angles. And today I want to provide just a snapshot of several of the artists who are covered in the book. And each of these artists contributed to the art form of gospel music in their own distinctive fashion. One of the anchors of the book is the late great Reverend James Cleveland, who in 1972 gained notoriety among those who didn't normally listen to gospel music when he appeared on the classic album by Aretha Franklin, Amazing Grace. And I want to say a little bit about that album. On Thursday night, January the 13th, 1972, an eclectic crowd of music lovers assembled at New Temple Missionary Baptist Church in Los Angeles, California, to witness Aretha Louise Franklin deliver one of the most amazing performances of her career on such gospel classics as What a Friend We Have in Jesus, How I Got Over, and Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Aretha Franklin fused the optimistic spirit of the civil rights movement, the cultural ethos of the Black Power Revolution, and the prophetic vision of the Black church to create a transcendent work of art. The atmosphere in New Temple was electric as her soaring shouts and deep moans sent chills down the spines of women and men, Blacks and whites, regular churchgoers, and self-proclaimed atheists. 4 months later, Atlantic Records released these performances as a double album entitled Amazing Grace. Now, despite her phenomenal success in the secular world, Franklin wanted to return, if only momentarily, to the sacred music of her youth. Such an album, she insisted, had to be recorded with a live choir, with a live congregation, and it had to be recorded with the Reverend James Cleveland. Franklin's insistence on Cleveland's involvement in Amazing Grace was a testament to her faith in his artistry and his unrivaled stature in the gospel music industry. With his signature voice, distinctive phrasing, and innovative choir arrangements, James Cleveland scored a series of hits during the 1960s and the 1970s. And by the 1960s, he really established himself as the most important and powerful gospel artist of his generation. He was an ambitious musician whose artistic goals extended beyond just his own individual success. In 1967, for example, he established the Gospel Music Workshop of America. He wanted to provide an institutional space for Black artists to develop their work, to develop their craft. The noted novelist Toni Morrison once said, "I want to do for Black publishing what James Cleveland did for the Gospels." This was Toni Morrison in 1974. Cleveland had a deep commitment to the preservation of the Black sacred tradition. But his commitment was not just about aesthetics. It was also about politics. Gospel music, Cleveland believed, was a vehicle through which Black religious leaders could address larger problems: racial injustice, economic inequality, class divisions within the Black community. Another artist who shared his viewpoint was Shirley Caesar, a native of Durham, North Carolina, born in 1938. One would be hard-pressed to find an artist, a gospel artist, who has enjoyed her level of success for a longer period of time. First working with the famous Caravans from the late 1950s to the mid-1960s, then striking out on her own to become one of gospel music's most successful performers, Shirley Caesar boasts, an incredibly diverse discography that captures her remarkable range as an artist. Her hits include sermonettes, traditional hymns, soulful tunes, and country ballads. I want to play just a little bit of her music, and I hope that you can hear this.
Oh, teach me, Master. Master, teach me. Oh, teach me how to wait.
That voice. As one of the gospel industry's most popular performers, Caesar used her platform to advance the art form, to fulfill her evangelical mission, and to build what religious studies scholar Cheryl Sanders calls a prophetic community. By prophetic community, Sanders means the exercising of one's individual gifts of ministry and leadership toward the end of empowering congregations to hear the voice of God and speak the word of God in conversation with the deepest concerns of the people and the communities one is called to serve. So Shirley Caesar has this incredibly rich career that also engaged religious issues, but also political issues. She addressed the problems of war, the problems of economic inequality. She also addressed the problems of class divisions within the Black community. One of her most famous songs or sermonettes was called Shouting John. In 1988, Caesar released her critically acclaimed album Live in Chicago. And that album would dominate the gospel charts for months. And that album featured a sermonette, a hit single called Hold My Mule. It centered on this fictive character called Shouting John. He was an 86-year-old farmer who, in the words of Caesar, had joined a dead church, controlled by ministers who frowned on his ecstatic style of worship, his expressive style of worship. To no avail, church leaders repeatedly attempted to subdue John during his extended praise breaks, by grabbing his limbs or forcing him to return to his seat. Frustrated by John's refusal to discipline his religious fervor, a small group of church officials traveled to the elder's home to chastise him for his behavior. Upon their arrival, they find John plowing in the field. Showing no compassion for the elder, the church leaders deliver an ultimatum to John. If you don't stop shouting, if you don't stop dancing, we're going to put you out of our church. If church officials expected John to give in to their demands after this threat of disfellowship, they were in for a major, major disappointment. When granted the opportunity to speak, John details his many blessings, his ownership of land, his good health, his trouble-free children. And then he notes, well, put me out. I can't hold my peace. A spiritually ecstatic John then proceeds to dance and shout all over his property. Throughout the country, gospel listeners couldn't get enough of this song. this tale of Shouting John, an everyday man who finished on top, a triumphant character whose life trajectory did not fit neatly into popular tales of the urban crisis. Women and men who looked at their lives in totality and felt they had been shown God's favor, identified with John, Shouting John. Caesar's vision of a beloved community was not only evident in her music, but also in her political work. In 1987, for example, she ran for a seat on Durham City Council and she won. She made the argument that the church had a responsibility to the community, noting that she wanted to, quote, focus on the needy and not the greedy. She campaigned on a platform emphasizing full employment, quality housing for low-income residents, improving downtown without sacrificing the needs of the poor, protecting the environment, and quality public schools. In explaining her political activism, she noted, "I not only care what happens inside the church, I'm equally concerned about what happens in society at large. In my opinion, if the church doesn't influence society, it has failed to live out God's mission." Shirley Caesar was far from alone in her endeavors. Submerging their art in the rhythms and narratives of the post-industrial world, many gospel artists revolutionized the sound of gospel music through their incorporation of funk and hip hop. They also expanded the lyrical content of gospel by confronting the realities of post-industrial America, the persistence of economic inequality, the persistence of racism, the persistence of health disparities. Many gospel artists in the 1980s also confronted the AIDS epidemic. And many gospel artists begin to talk about also, not all, but some, about what the AIDS epidemic was doing to the Black church and by extension, the gospel community. That's also the story that I wanna tell in this book. I wanna tell the story of how gospel artists engage the political world. And one of the people that I talk about in relationship to this is the great Walter Hawkins. Walter Hawkins, of course, was the brother of Edwin Hawkins, who achieved popularity in the late 1960s with the song, "Oh Happy Day." So between 1968 and 1985, Walter Hawkins composed and performed songs that remained central to the Black sacred experience in the United States. A spirit of inclusivity undergirded his music and his theology. Throughout his church, or through his church, the Love Center, and through his music, he attempted to deal with the many issues facing African Americans, particularly in his hometown of Oakland, California. Deindustrialization, unemployment, and various forms of violence wreaked havoc on African American communities living in the Bay Area. Moreover, the AIDS epidemic had a devastating impact on thousands of Oakland and San Francisco residents, including some who attended Hawkins's church. One of the most open secrets in the gospel industry was how this devastating disease was decimating church choirs across the country. And to his credit, Walter Hawkins did not ignore this reality. In 1989, his church converted a 6-story house into a shelter called the Ark. One beneficiary of the Ark services was this woman named Christine Whitty, a young mother infected with the AIDS virus whose downtown apartment had been destroyed during the devastating earthquake of 1989. Another recipient of the art services was a Detroit native named Gerald Mann, who had been diagnosed with AIDS in 1982. Mann said this, "These people didn't know me, but they opened the doors and let me in. They didn't ask me whether I was straight or gay. They said, come in." Through not only his music, but his social activism, Hawkins embodied what it meant to spread the good news. And that's part of the story that I want to tell in When Sunday Comes, the ways in which African-American artists, from the Winans to the Hawkins family, to the Clark sisters, to James Cleveland, to Andre Crouch, to the Staples singers, attempted to spread the good news. And so I look forward to the conversation and the questions.
Thank you so much, Claudrena. Fantastic.